Well, thank you for the introduction. I'm pleased to be here. Mým českým kolegům rád bych jako občan státu Nebraska už 41 let a 7 měsíců, že vítám vás do Lincolnu. Just wanted to welcome Czech colleagues here from somebody who's lived in Nebraska, not long enough to be a true Nebraskan. As I said, I was only here for 41 years and 7 months, that doesn't quite do it. You have to be born here to be a true Nebraskan, I think. But anyway, glad to be here. I did want to run through, before I talk, rather than interrupt the talk with some pictures, just to give you a little sense of what some people looked like. I have many friends like to feature more, but time is limited. First, I'd like those of the young people in the audience to know that I was once young myself. It's been quite a while, but this is November, mid-November 1967. My wife Karen and I are atop the famous bridge built by the Turks in the 16th century over the Neretva River in Mostar. Some of you will know that the Serbs, during the Civil War of 1993 in Yugoslavia, demolished the bridge, and thanks to UNESCO funds, it was reconstructed in 2004. I do want to give some sense of what I remember of Czechoslovakia, and maybe a little bit of the United States of 50, 51 years ago, is in many cases not the same way I look back on it and try to understand it today. That's come out in some of the interesting talks that we've all heard already. But who would have thought when we were there in 67, in spite of the many tensions inside of communist Yugoslavia, that it would blow apart in the early 1990s. Our son, my wife earned a PhD in history too. We were both PhD students. She earned a PhD in history at UCLA in French history. Our son in the picture is today the Associate Professor of English at Butler University. He'll be the department chairperson next year, and he specializes in 20th century British literature. Our daughter is also a scholar, well-published scholar, Valerie Garver, in early medieval Europe, especially the Carolingian Empire. Let's just quickly pop through the pictures. Like every student tourist in former Czechoslovakia, we visited, among other things, castle ruins. Here, a Yale classmate of mine, Bill Weary and I, are as far high as we were then allowed to climb on Hazemberg, the magnificent Gothic castle ruin in the Zahrad, in the Zahrada Czech, the Garden of Bohemia. My wife took the picture. It was a little circuitous to haul our son up in a backpack, so we didn't do it. And of course, this has had great associations to me with the poet Karl Heinrich Macha, who wrote the famous poem Svati Hazemberg. Please, the next, quickly. Another fascinating aspect of being in old communist Czechoslovakia was it was a virtual, in 1967, it was a truly open-air transport museum of immense size and interest. I taught transport history at UNO for years. It was always a popular course, and was fascinated by everything that was on the street. The communists had just relaxed the confiscatory taxes on private automobiles, and a lot of them were coming out of storage since the legislation had been passed back in 48 or 49. This is a Tatra 87. Some of you will recognize Tatra introduced the air-cooled rear engine to automotive world in 1928. Aerodynamic design came as early as 1932. And I mention this because my mentor, the man who inspired me to study Czech history, S. Harrison Thompson at the University of Colorado, as I shall relate, owned a Tatra 87. He performed his own repairs on it. This was in the late 50s, early 60s, when I was an undergraduate at Colorado, with parts he ordered from Czechoslovakia. So that car has a great meaning. We students at Colorado in those days used to call it the Batmobile. And it does resemble that. We often got together with colleagues. I'll talk about Husuf Spor. In 1967, this photo dates from 71 when we were back, or I was back, my wife wasn't back in 71. And these are some of the people we knew there. Historian, some of you may know, of modern Romania, Miroslav Teichmann. I'll say more about him, his first wife, Renata, my sister-in-law, Libby Goss. If you can recognize me, the young guy who's standing next to sister-in-law Libby. Then Miroslav Teichmann Sr., who was the sexton of the church, Miroslav, the scholar's father, and Olda Vít, who was at that time a divinity student studying for the priesthood in the Czechoslovak church. More about these people later. I had brought in my brother-in-law and sister-in-law because I was serving as his translator at the Czech Radio Observatory. He's one of the first specialists, world specialists in radio astronomy, and is now writing a history of it, and retired several years ago as head of the very large array in New Mexico. Once back with friends we had made at Husuf Spor of the Czechoslovak Church in Prague, I was introduced to several couples who had fled Czechoslovakia after the Soviet invasion. Didn't know them there, but my wife and I sponsored them. And if they had a sponsor and a job, which we obtained through a good friend in the church who was manager of an iron foundry in Brantford, Connecticut, we brought them in. One couple, Carl Klapp and Vera, nee Kratokville, Kratokvilova Klapp, had their young son, Pavel, baptized in our church shortly after their arrival in 1969. My wife standing alongside them as the godmother. This is in First Center Church on the Green in New Haven. I'll make a quick contrast with what I remember of the turbulent 1960s in the service of the U.S. Navy, and then in the one of the great social experiments of the Johnson administration, the model cities in Florence Virtue Homes. I should perhaps just say quickly a word about it here. It was over 100 units designed by architect Johnson in Stamford, Connecticut, a very noted modern architect, garden apartments, and to integrate it, the predominantly black Dixwell Avenue Congregational Church recruited Yale graduate students to live there. There was a down payment of $300, you bought a share in the cooperative, and then the rent was like we ended up with a three-bedroom apartment after we came back from Czechoslovakia the second time in 73, which was only $125 a month. And we left when we went over income and bought a small house in North Haven, Connecticut. But there's my wife and the same little boy now moving on his own. Still the same snowsuit. You can see he's pretty well outgrown it. We were frugal in those days. This picture actually was in the New Haven Register when they were touting the newly integrated housing project. That did not turn out in the end as well as the Johnson administration and the Merrily administration in New Haven had hoped. Like a lot of events in the 60s, what happened was different than what a lot of us hoped and would happen and tried to make happen. Joe Svoboda. I'll mention him here. Here's his picture, very nice picture of Joe, speaking and interviewing for the Czech Heritage Collection that he founded. This is 1976. He's interviewing Anton Piskach, the leading publisher of Czech language material in Omaha during most of the 20th century. I'll have, if time permits, perhaps say a few more words about both of them later. But Joe is one of the two people to whom I have dedicated the book that will come out December of this year, March of next year. I met both of these people within weeks of arriving in Nebraska, and valued their friendship. In fact, when my wife and I were looking for a family physician, I went through the list of physicians, and sure enough was the name Anton Piskach. So I said, must be a relative. I called him up. Sure enough, he was the grandson of the Anton Piskach I knew. And he was, until he retired a few years ago, he was my wife's and my personal physician. So you see, if you'll remember the famous words, I think it's Lieutenant Lukash in The Good Soldier's Fake, being Czech is like being a member of a secret society. One of the famous cliches, now cliches, in that book. The Czech Cultural Club of Omaha, I was welcomed into that right away. Still, there were many immigrants. This is 1976. Many immigrants and children of immigrants whose Czech was excellent. It was a great club. It still is a great club, and I've been a member now 41 and a half years and served twice as a past president. Here we're at the former Bohemian Cafe of Omaha at Christmas in 1979. Frank Smirsch on the far right translated American popular songs, Christmas carols, into Czech, as well as leading us in the singing of Czech songs, and wrote the songbook for the club. Coming to this was like going back to my wife's and my student days in communist Czechoslovakia. The same camaraderie, fellowship, the singing of songs, Czech folk songs, more of the modern popular music in Czechoslovakia than in the United States, where the repertoire was largely late 19th century, the songs of parents and grandparents. One of the members was a legionnaire of World War I. And this will remind me, I do want to briefly in my talk mention 1918. But this, Joe Sklenich, gave a long lecture in Czech on his experience as a Czechoslovak legionnaire in Siberia to the Omaha community. We had a great turnout, March 1977. Joe was a great guy, he told us about his journey, and then Joe Svoboda went back and interviewed him four times, really his life story. And it's fascinating. For those of you who know Czech, you can read it here in our magnificent Czech collection in among the more than 55 tapes that Joe made of reminiscences of early Nebraska Czech settlers. We had occasion here at UNL to invite scholars back twice from the Czech Republic, once for a conference on human rights in 1992, and again this conference also that year, Joe Svoboda and I organized of the Czech American experience, which led to publication of a double issue of Nebraska History with that title, now online and available to everyone. Another group I encountered, and I'll explain how this happened fortuitously, was the famous Osada Banako. And this occurred in the fall of 1990, and I'll talk about that later. Great fellowship group. My wife and I were most recently back at a meeting of Banako in May of 2013. Alas, like so many of the people I'll mention in the talk, most of these people are no longer with us in this world. I was honored in early October of 1990 in being inducted as an honorary member of Banako, along with František Dostal here. This is a couple of years later after we became honorary members. He's the author of a number of illustrated books with his own photographs and commentary. For example, Život je pes is one of the books. The other two of the four inductees were, much to my great pleasure, Jiří Suchý. I think he needs no introduction to the speakers of Czech in the audience, but one of the principals, in fact the principal, founder and advocate of the semaphore Sedum Malik Forum, Foru in in Prague, and then the grand old man of Czechoslovak Boy Scouts, Jaroslav Foglar, as a really active scout myself through my early adolescence, I was really glad to make his acquaintance, actually more than his acquaintance. So, one last one. I went back frequently. I was back almost every year in the Czechoslovakia, then became the Czech Republic in the early, mid-90s, and I would always bring back, in this case, I brought back a series of art prints from the Jocelyn Art Museum and distributed them to the Bonaco members. Okay, that's just a sample of what things used to look like. Now, we can shut it down, unless you want to keep that handsome Joe Jostin photo up on the screen, it's fine. Let me first address the question that puzzled most Czechs. Why an American would show up without any Czech ancestors, and I recently had my Y-DNA tested out of over 4,200 markers, only 5 show up in Bohemia, and they're probably Germans. Why someone would have learned Czech, which I had learned fairly well at Yale in 2 years of intensive study, would come over to Czechoslovakia. That puzzled people. A vždycky v této době byl nutná přemýšlet jako Esteban. It was really necessary in those days in Czechoslovakia to think like a secret policeman, because those were our Cold War adversaries. And certainly, when they saw a Czech-speaking American with no Czech ancestors come over, so mysleli. Pravděpodobně, že přijezdění takový Američan do komunistické Československa, pravděpodobně to byl vytokonalým krytem. Přijezdí spolu s manželkou a malým dítětem. It was perfect cover to the secret policeman's mentality for Yale to send over a CIA agent with a wife and a small baby. But of course, the truth is not that, because I never worked for or ever wanted to work for the CIA. But I think the closest and most concise explanation I ever heard of why I studied Czech was from another one of my advisors, Školiteli, in communist Czechoslovakia in 67, Milan Švankmajer, specialist in Russian history. Milan někdy mě řekl, že každý Američan, který se učí česky, je jako Čech, který se učí estonštině. He said, any American who learns, he said, poprvé, říkal, že Bruce, vy jste úplně blázný člověk. Potom, každý American. Bruce, you're a crazy man. Any American who learns Czech is like a Czech who learns Estonian. Estonian spoken by slightly more than a million figures. Now, when Milan Švankmajer mentioned this, he had no idea that my ancestry is heavily Finnish, which is, of course, close relatives of the linguistic DNA relatives of the Estonians across the Gulf of Finland. But that's probably the best explanation, but it is truly more complicated than that, and here I would like to give a small commercial to the younger people I see in the audience about the importance of studying foreign languages. I studied Czech for 2 years at Yale. I'd actually been a French major until I became a history major at Colorado. But let me go back to start the languages very, very quickly. And to high school, when I realized, and so did my parents, that to gain admission to a good university, I would need to have in those days at least a high school French on my, or high school language on my record. At our local high school, I had a choice of Latin, French, or Spanish, and I chose French. I was very lucky to have had an extraordinarily fine teacher. This is also an argument to support your public schools and pay the taxes necessary to see that the younger generation in this country has at least the same opportunities that their grandparents, my generation, had and their parents had. Miss Fry, she was then a woman in her early 40s, very, very strict. Now, I grew up, hard for young people to believe, in an era when self-esteem was a concept, so far as I know, had not yet been invented. And in fact, I never heard about it until I was well into middle age, by which time it was too late to have had any influence on my development. But Miss Fry insisted that everybody did their lesson every day. Very important in the study of foreign language. You don't dare fall behind. And Miss Fry's technique was, if you didn't know the answer to one of her questions, hadn't studied the assignment, she didn't pass on to another student. She asked you another question, and then another question, and then another question. Well, I watched this technique in the second day of class, and she reduced my good friend Tommy Joseph to tears. And I remember thinking silently to myself, now Tommy Joseph was the first string guard on the Worthington High School football team. I was the second string guard. He was a tougher, better football player than I was, and I wasn't bad. And I remember saying to myself, that woman will never do that to me. So I really did, of course, what she wanted, which was to learn my lessons very well, though that had not, I confess, been my original intention. The other great bonus of learning French so well was the fact that I learned English grammar for the first time. I discovered that English grammar had a logic, and it had a fascination to it. And before, I had to diagram sentence and memorize parts of vocabulary, which I found dreadfully dull, and since I could get A's in English without learning all that stuff, I didn't try very hard. I was not a very good student in that respect. But then suddenly the scales fell from my eyes and a whole new world opened. And I really learned French well. I don't think I ever got better than a B+, but I really learned it well. And I remember going home, that we students used to call Miss Fry the old battle axe. I remember going home once and grumbling to my mother after she'd humiliated another classmate one day, saying, that Miss Fry's an old battle axe. Well, my mother got on my case right away and said, you don't go around calling any adult those names. You don't walk in their shoes. And she said, and my mother knew Miss Fry socially. My mother said, besides, she lost her boyfriend in the war. And there in the mid-50s, the war meant World War II. So after that, I did look at Miss Fry in an entirely new light, and I dropped the old battle axe reference. But she was a great teacher. I went back to her 10 years after graduated from high school and thanked her, by which time she was getting ready to retire, saying, my methods of teaching are no longer acceptable. Parents and the school board won't put up with them, which was sort of too bad. Well, I went on, Colorado. I met S. Harrison Thompson. He was the inspiration to me to study modern Czech history. Some of you as old as I am, or maybe a couple of people here in the audience older, will remember the name S. Harrison Thompson. I was a French major at Colorado. I was in advanced composition conversation my sophomore year, and my teacher, Madame Jeanine Oakst, asked me, she said, have you ever taken a class from Professor S. Harrison Thompson? I said, oh, no, I had not. She said, well, you really should. He's the best professor on campus. So I immediately went over to the student bookstore at the university, looked up the reading list, and lo and behold, one of the books was S. Harrison Thompson, Czechoslovakia in European History, the second edition.
So I thought, this man's got a book at Princeton in the second edition, and I leafed through it and looked very interesting. So I signed up, and I became a history major with a French minor. Thompson was an extraordinary man. I said he drove the Tatra 87, did his own repairs on it. He delighted in brilliant half-truths, something I don't think I have the wit or the talent as an actor to pull off. I always can see or visualize my students scribbling down a half-truth, however clever, and then thinking perhaps a day or a year or 5 years later that this was the gospel truth, which of course it isn't. But Thompson delighted in these. The first day of class, I still remember, he asked our class, this is the fall of 1958, all right? He said, why have the Germans been such bad actors in our century? Now to me, 13 years as a teenager had been an eternity, practically my whole conscious life. And I didn't pop up with an answer, nor did anybody else. And then Professor Thompson said, oh, he said, that's very easy to answer. Of course it isn't. German history is very complicated. I won't go into that, but you all know that that's the case. And finally, when no student responded, he answered his own question. He said, that's easy. He said, in the 19th century, all the decent Germans moved to the United States. Having had a German great-grandfather who came with 8 siblings and parents and a couple of a niece and a nephew or two, to the Ohio in the mid-1850s, I was somewhat flattered. But anyway, this was Professor Thompson. He called each student in for an individual interview, and I remember he asked this to every student, I discovered later, what foreign languages do you know? Well, I was a French major, and I thought I was pretty good. So I spoke back to him in French and explained to him that I had learned French, and I suppose I even looked slightly pleased with myself, which I probably shouldn't have done. And I still remember he said, you've been here 2 years already, and you haven't studied German? And I said, no. He said, well, another half-truth, Germans have written more history than anybody else. English far surpasses German in that department, and Russian probably equals it. He said, most of it's wrong-headed, but you've got to read it anyway, you've got to understand it, and you need to know German. And if I were you, you're wasting your parents' money. It turned out it was the Navy's money, because I was going there on a Naval ROTC scholarship. Get right out there and study German. Well, I was an impressionable young man, and that's what I did. I dropped geography or something, and I signed up for German, and I've never regretted it. So there was a second language. In the Navy, as an officer, I studied Italian. I hoped to get a posting to Naples that way, but I met my wife while I was in the Navy in Southern California, married her, and then I asked to be my second station to be on a ship in Long Beach so I could be near her when she started graduate school at UCLA. But I never forgot the Italian, and I went back and picked it up later, and I taught Italian history and Italian history through film and literature at UNO for most of the early part of the 20th century. One language leads to another. I think Miss Fry gave me the confidence I could learn a language, and it had never dawned on me that I ever had the ability. And once I got the desire, I knew that I could learn a language if I slogged through it patiently and, of course, got lots of help. Well, at Yale, of course, I was very fortunate because Yale in those days, it still is, but especially in those days, was a great center for Czech as well as Slavic studies. Peter Demitz was one of my advisors. All of you know, most of you know his book, Prague in Gold and Black. Marx, Engels, and Die Dichter, another book. He was professor of German, but he also, of course, grew up as a young man in the 30s and early 40s in Bohemia, and knew the language and the culture well. His first wife, Hanna Demetsova, was my Czech language instructor, first year Czech at Yale. And she was also, as many of you know, a very talented novelist. Meine Amerikanische Tochter was the first book, I think, that's been translated, My American Daughter, but probably most famous for those of us interested in Czech history, the author of The House on Prague Street. Five of us started first year Czech at Yale, all of us graduate students. Three of us finished. But Yale was flush with money in those days. And for the three of us to continue in second year Czech hired Zdenka Pospíšilová, professor of art history at Southern Connecticut State College, to teach the course. So this was another wonderful thing about being at Yale. The attention and the help was forthcoming. Of course, a very demanding, very, very demanding curricula in all departments at Yale. And Yale got their money's worth, I think, because all three of the students became professors. I ended up at UNO in history, Billy Hamilton at SUNY Buffalo in Slavic languages and literatures, and Joe Lake, who grew up in Tabor, South Dakota, just north of here, at the University of Massachusetts as professor of Slavic languages and literature. The other Czech faculty at Yale, Rene Velik in the comparative literature, the Leopold Pospíšil, Zdenka's husband in anthropology. These people were present. Plus, there were others who knew Czech well, could speak Czech. Piotr Vondich, my dissertation advisor, served in the Polish Army in the West during World War II, and went on to a very, very distinguished career. Six books on Polish, modern Polish history, one including one general history of Poland. The Viktor Erlich in Slavic linguistics. Viktor Erlich knew Czech, of course, and other Slavic languages. The and Karl Deutsch, also on my dissertation committee, born in Bohemia. I came in to see him for the first time for an interview. I never took a course from him, but I'd read his books, and he said, "Hey, Sokolove, Muzhne Vepshedu," you know, right away. And so I knew what that was. It was a slogan of the Sokols, "Hail Sokols, manfully onward." And that was, he was a wonderful man. He left within a year. He went to Harvard. Harvard lured him away. But I had lots of encouragement. Jaroslav Pelikan was born in Chicago of Slovak parents. His father was a Slovak Lutheran minister, and Jaroslav Pelikan went on to write the first comprehensive history of Christian doctrine since Adolf von Harnack's Dogmengeschichte appeared in the early 20th century. So I lots of, and I was able, instrumental in getting Jaroslav Pelikan out to receive an honorary doctorate from UNO back in the early 80s, along with another former student of his at UNO, the late Ron Burke, then in the philosophy department. So this was a wonderful place to be at Yale. So off we went to communist Czechoslovakia. Let me go back very quickly to my first impressions. They are indelible of the place. Now, I'd been inspired by Thompson, and of course, it didn't take me long. I didn't expect to find Hussites, and I certainly didn't. But the impressions, the early impressions are roughly these. I was struck immediately by the utter squalor in public places. Filth, dirt, apartments, stairwells, restrooms, even parks were not tidily managed. And then the contrast to this, I went inside of modest apartments, even in Panilaki, the prefab concrete high-rise apartment buildings, and I found a clean, not well furnished, but a clean, warm, welcoming atmosphere. And of course, immediately I was struck by the contrast. This was quite the opposite of what communism was supposed to produce. It was supposed to produce care for that which is we have in common, and less emphasis upon that which we have as individuals, but just the opposite. And I never lost that impression. In fact, I was so used to it, when I went back after a 17-year absence, almost 17-year absence in 1990, in those days you could do this, I carried a small bottle of Clorox and other cleaning gear. I shipped it through in my suitcase, and when I checked into the Fiesta, the Star, the student dormitory, Na Pechinak, on the Pechini, on the west side of Prague, the first thing I did was strip down, turn on the shower, clean the restroom from floor to as far up the wall as I could go with Clorox, left the apartment, opened the windows, went out for dinner with friends. Now that return produced another meeting with one of my fine student advisors in former communist Czechoslovakia, Karel Piklík, the Charter 77 man, who guided me through much of my dissertation work in early 20th century Czech history. Well, I had arranged with Karel Piklík. He said, first thing, he said, I want you to come have breakfast with me on your first full day in Prague. He said, I will send the driver from the Vojenský historický ústav. I'll send the driver around to pick you up. Now, Karel Piklík was dismissed in early 69 from the Vojenský historický ústav, where I knew him and other scholars, for the brilliant book he wrote on Bezlegend, Československa zahraniční odboj, 1914-1918, his book on the foreign struggle, the struggle for Czechoslovak independence abroad, 1914 to 1918. Well, he was restored after the Velvet Revolution as the head of the Vojenský historický. He hadn't been the head, but he became the head after the Velvet Revolution as a talented, intelligent, independently minded, at least to the degree anybody could be under Marx-Leninism, scholars were brought back into positions of authority. And guess who was driving the Institute's automobile sent to pick me up? Anybody want to come up with this? Why, the man who had fired him back in 1969. Now, it was characteristic of the, I would say, the decency, considering all that the communists had done that was vicious, stupid, and obnoxious, to have brought back a colleague and not forced him into early retirement vindictively, but brought him back to perform useful work at the Institute. And we had quite a bit in common. I mentioned I'd been in the Navy, and he said he'd been in the Army, so we had military service in common. And that was something to talk about in the drive to the Institute. Then Karel Piklík and I went out to breakfast. I could go on with more Karel Piklík stories, but we always used to meet when I was back in Prague in the 90s. We would meet at the Jungmann statue in Jungmannovo Namjesti. That was our meeting place. Great man. So now go back to perhaps some other first impressions. So clearly I never entertained the notion that the Czechs are a particularly unique or extraordinarily heroic people. They are a tough people. They have had a history in common with small nations that is in many respects very admirable, but they also have torn each other to pieces. The Hussite Wars was a civil war among Czechs, as you know, the 30 Years' War too. And, of course, the fighting in the 19th century. Karl Sabina was an Austrian police informer who wrote the librettos for Smetana's operas. So I did not idealize Czechs, although I hadn't expected communism to be quite as dirty and as incompetent and stupid. And I could go on with some other adjectives, but I won't, as I discovered it. Now, the bright side was that Czechs still managed to create an attractive social life for themselves, and one into which they welcomed my wife and me as foreigners. Now, it helped to have our young son, Lee, with us. Everybody loves babies, toddlers, regardless of political outlook. But the first thing we did, we decided, since we were regular churchgoers, we decided we'd show up at a church on Sunday morning. We did, I think it was the third week into the country, second or third Sunday into the country. And we picked a close-by church that was famous, Husuf Spor, which had actually been the place, as many of you probably know, of the Rothlas for the Czechoslovak uprising against the Germans in May 1945. And we showed up there, and we were welcomed. Now, the problem was we showed up with little Lee, and they had no provision to take care of him, but one of the older ladies in the congregation took him out into some room in the church and amused him while we sat through the service. Afterward, I was introduced. There were no young people in the church. The church was people older than we, a lot older than we were. But the minister said, I'd like you to meet some of the youth, and why don't you come to this address tonight? Bring your wife and your son and meet some of the younger people, and that I did. So I met the youth group that met outside of the church. Now, their public appearance as regular churchgoers or devout Christians was not something that was, of course, that was something that was discouraged. But we met some wonderful people this way. And what immediately impressed me about this youth group, we met in the home of Vladimir Yerzhina Kozderovi, the Kozderas. They lived in an apartment with their mother, they just married, they ultimately had four children, they had a huge Great Dane in a three-room apartment, but it was cozy, and we crowded in, and I was impressed by the way they worked together. They had officers, they had an agenda, they moved smoothly through it, they planned activities, we went on camping trips with them in the Šumava, and I thought, These are great and normal people. And this, of course, this is what you didn't see as you looked at the dirt and the slime of public face of socialism, which, of course, Czechs were, they had socialism, they were only building communism. The nirvana had not arrived. So these are extraordinary contrasts that I mentioned. So I cannot say that when the stirrings of a different life began in 67 that I was entirely surprised. We were there during the famous Writers' Conference of June 1967. And there was a lot of excitement about this. And ever so, particularly Vaculík's speech there to the Writers' Conference, which wasn't in the controlled newspapers but was widely talked about. On the anniversary of Masaryk's death in 1937, the 30th anniversary, Literárny Listy published an article stating that not since Masaryk had anyone done any positive work toward resolving the Czech question or addressing constructively the future of the Czechs and Slovaks in Europe. So things were astir. And I had agreed before we departed to write a paper in presentation for a celebration that the Historický ústav of the Československé Academy of Věd, the Historical Institute of the Czechoslovak Academy of Sciences, was planning for October 1968 to celebrate 50 years of Czechoslovak independence. I wrote my article about Czech politics in the 1890s. I sent it in on time, which was mid-May, was planning. I had airline tickets and everything to go back to Prague and looking forward to this in October. But of course, the Soviet invasion came on the 20th of August of that year, and you could not celebrate 50 years of Czechoslovak independence under those circumstances. So I had to cancel the airline tickets, but the editors at the Historical Institute rushed into print every paper that they'd received for the anniversary in two volumes, hastily, but they put them out, and this was my first publication. Now, it was, for the work of a graduate student, much in need of improvement. But it was good to get it out in the public domain because I received criticism of it that helped me enormously when I wrote my dissertation on the Young Czech Party and then turned that into a book on the Young Czech Party and the emergence of a multi-party system. So that worked well. So there was I sensed strongly the disappointment that occurred. Now, other speakers have talked about, and others still will, who know the situation better than I ever did, about the experience with reform communism. At the time, it was not altogether certain that it would fail, as it did. I shared the hopes of many who thought, well, if it works, it would at least be an improvement and a step in the right direction. And I shared those, if you will, hopes or illusions, though not, I myself was not very directly involved in that type of activity. Back at Yale in 68, I was a reader for Wolfgang Leonhardt, who also knew Czech, by the way, who was a visiting professor at Yale every spring and taught a very popular course on the Soviet Union. We had over 300 students. They packed the largest hall at Yale and were eager students. And one of the students whose papers I remember grading was Howard Dean. Needs no introduction to those of you interested in American politics over the last 35, 40 years, former governor of Vermont and head of the Democratic National Committee. So I worked for Leonhardt. And of course, the big issue of that course, and this was a lively issue discussed, was, is Stalinism the antithesis of Leninism, or is Stalinism the logical continuation of Leninism? Now, this was a debatable question. Being a pretty decent student, I could argue both sides of that question, and I had to know that students could take their choice in Leonhardt's class. Now, that was always the final question for the final exam. He'd ask them, what do you think? And then they had to back it up with evidence. We now know what the answer was. Stalinism was a logical continuation of Leninism. The rot started in the ideology, which arguably goes back to German idealism, if you want to push it back as far as Kant. I'm a man who admires Pufendorf, not Kant, among those who dealt with the political issues of the Enlightenment era in Germany, but I won't go into that discussion. But all in all, it was for my wife and for me a wonderful experience. Now, one of the other troubling aspects, I'd say probably the most troubling aspects of it, both when we were there together in 9.5 months in 67 and 5.5 months in 1973, and when I was over for a month in 1971, was the fact that our best friends were likely to be the ones who reported on us to the Statne Bezpečnosti, to the Estibazi, to the state secret police. And so one had to be very, I was extremely careful, not in my own views about history or about the United States, where I would speak my mind quite clearly, but I never, ever, and my wife didn't either, ever talked about one Czech in front of another, because you could not know who you might get into trouble. So I never spoke about anyone's opinions or about what I did with other people, except if it was in a group and everybody knew what we were doing. But even each group had its, if you will, minder or informant. Now, there were lots of ways to meet people, and I took advantage of them, knowing enough Czech to carry on a decent conversation. Another group I sought out was a group of model railroad enthusiasts. This had been a hobby of mine, pretty much in abeyance since I'd gone to graduate school, but I knew the I knew the field, I knew the equipment, I had built model railroad equipment and operated it. So I showed up at the Model Railroad Club in Žižkov. I asked if the local Železničnih Modelarzu, Kram's Železničnik Modelarzu, the store for railroad modelers, if such a club existed, and I asked where I lived, and sure enough, and he said, well, there's one close by, so I would walk over the hill to Žižkov. Occasionally, early in the evening, I'd take our son along. He wasn't speaking yet, but he appreciated watching the trains run around the layout. So these people were good modelers, and they knew things well. But they always had the head guy, I liked him, Pepe Vachta. I was pretty sure he was a Communist Party member, but he was a decent guy, very good modeler. But there was another guy who came around every now and then and gave a pep talk on Marx-Leninism. And I was warned, they were embarrassed, but of course I wanted to stay and hear it. He said, you don't have to stay. And I said, no, I'll stay. I was interested to hear what the guy had to say. So every group was watched. And this was true of stamp collectors. It was true of butterfly collectors. It was true of anybody that had any interest of any sort, even sort of bizarre interest like I had, like in model railroads. But that was the way the system worked. The communists, they were afraid of their own shadow. They didn't trust anybody to meet anywhere for fear that someone would bring up probably what a lousy mess the country was in and talk about it amongst themselves. So those impressions were lasting. Another very valuable thing, my colleagues, now everybody, all the students at the university were either children of communists or their parents were of impeccably working class background, I knew this. All of the members of the institutes where I worked, the faculty at the university where I studied advanced Czech with Professor Holub in 1967 were communists or they wouldn't be there. But I never have been one to let politics interfere with friendship. That's very important in Nebraska, believe me. And it was, of course, especially true over there. The other habit I had, and it usually worked out, it's worked out well for me, I think that maybe because I've been lucky, I would strike up conversation, the most casual conversations with strangers in restaurants where I would go for lunch, or on trains where I traveled, and start talking to them about them. One of my favorite gambits was to tell them what a wonderful country it was, and I was interested in transport history, and how I was delighted to see all of the steam locomotives and different types, and I knew the types, I knew what they were, and I would wax eloquently about what a wonderful place Czechoslovakia was. And then if the countenance of my friend or my casual acquaintance turned to horror, then I knew I was probably not speaking to a communist. But then they clearly realized what I was up to. But this generally worked out pretty well. Another couple of incidents to illustrate that. In 1971, I spent 5 weeks in Prague in the late summer. And I went back and met old friends from the church, Miroslav Teichman. In fact, I stayed with Miroslav Teichman and his wife Renata, then wife Renata in their apartment. Worked in the state archives, did more research in turning my doctoral dissertation, just completed at Yale, starting to turn it into a book. And I was grateful, of course, in 67, 71, 73, and later, that my Czech advisors, and in some cases fellow students, helped me. For example, in 67, Miroslav Teichman took me over to the Sokol archive. I hadn't known about that. And he figured I'd look at that and I'd learn something, and I learned a lot. Zdeněk Šola, another one of my advisors, the foremost Marxist historian of the Czech labor movement, took me out to the summer home of Erik Maria Rilke, took me around to various other places where I would find useful information. And everybody I talked to admired, or professed to admire, T.G. Masaryk. And I don't think they were saying that to me because they knew it would please me. I'm a great admirer of Masaryk himself. One of those few world historical figures I admire, I don't want to say without reservation, but with very, very, very few. Garibaldi would be another. Abraham Lincoln in this country would be another. But they made sure I saw what I needed to see. And it wasn't the approved Marx-Leninist curriculum. Anyway, other fortuitous discussions with total strangers. One was actually very fortunate, because when I left in 71, I came out with two suitcases. In one suitcase were more than 80 issues of Reporter magazine, one of the most vigorous of the reformed communist publications criticizing the shortcomings of the pre-1968 communist regime. I also carried out for a good friend, the artist, Karl Neprosh, plans for an abstract sculpture that he was to display at an art exhibit in Munich, but was not allowed to because, having done some political cartooning in favor of the Dubček movement in reformed communism, he was fired as a teacher sculpture at the university, and he was prohibited from showing his artwork publicly, which is, of course, a hard, hard sentence to an author, much like Marta Kubishova, whom I greatly admired, was denied public performance of her interpretation of largely modern rock music. And also in the suitcase, one of the suitcases, I had the only 33 and a third RPM single large record that Marta Kubishova had produced. This was a treasure. I didn't want to lose that. I didn't want to lose Karl Neprosh's plans. The abstract sculpture was two huge human heads. If you know Karl Neprosh's work, he's been on postage stamps. Velký konverzace, for example, is on a postage stamp. And as a reward for my smuggling out his artwork, he gave to me and my wife an original print, which was called A Conversation. It shows two sort of inside views of human, abstract human heads. They're talking to each other. This is a Czech conversation, by the way. What do these human heads lack? There's no ears. It's all mouth. Just like his postage stamp, famous postage stamp picture, we have the museum poster with it on it in the house, shows these two abstract figures with nothing but blaring amplifiers facing each other. So I'm reminded of the Nebraska Czech saying, this is in good humor, by the way, you can always tell a Czech. You know the answer to that? But you can't tell him much. Now I sort of like argumentative people. I think fundamentally, if it isn't carried to extremes of the sort that Karl Neprosh satirized in his art, if it isn't carried to extremes, it's a commendable characteristic. People that have the courage of their opinions and stick up for them, even when you're doing your best to convince them that they're going down the wrong track. So anyway, I had all this valuable stuff in two suitcases and heading for the border. 71, the communists were nervous. I struck up a conversation in the apartment with a German lady and her daughter who'd been in Czechoslovakia as tourists. So we were chatting away in German, and I was talking about German relatives I had in Munich and several other places, third cousins. And we had a nice chat. Well, we got to the border. My mistake at the border was to, I think, have spoken Czech to the border guard. I regretted that immediately. He got suspicious. And he said, get off the train, this was in Czech, get off the train and bring your suitcase. He didn't say bring both suitcases. So, hoping he hadn't noticed that there were two, I grabbed the suitcase that had the reporter magazines, but not the suitcase in which was my treasured Marta Kubishova single and my Carl Neprosh's plans for his abstract sculpture. Oh, by the way, within this vise shaped like a human head, the museum had been instructed to place a pile more than a foot high of Rue de Prabo, the Communist Party daily, and then crank the vise together with the part of the Rue de Prabo showing out. So we had a cover story thought up. If the police found this, I would say, since I had an original drawing of Carl Neprosh there, the cover story was that I had purchased this drawing, which I hadn't, from Carl Neprosh. No, he gave me the drawing. That was true. That was entirely true. And that plans was, he said, this was were his plans for a piece of sculpture he was never going to realize, but when I had admired it, he gave it to me. That was the cover story. Well, fortunately, off the train I went with the suitcase. Well, I figure they're going to look in the suitcase, they'll probably take the magazines away from me, and then they'll probably get rid of me. Well, I waited and I waited, they were going through the suitcase, and I saw the train pull out of the station. It was gone. Off to Germany. And I was still in there, and they came back with a pile of, big smile on their face, they had this pile of reporter magazines. Who gave these to you? And I said, I don't know the man. I meanwhile had plenty of time to think up a story. I don't know the man. I said, he was some old guy. I'm sure he was a lot younger. The old guy I had in my imagination was a lot younger than I am now. But I said, I was coming out of a bookstore. I explained the bookstore. It was on a Taus, the Antiquariat on the Tauska Ulitsa at the corner of a Tauska Ulitsa. And this old man came up to me, seeing me carrying out a load of books. And I had those books with receipts. Those were in the bag, too. So they would have known I would have been at that bookstore. And I said, this man came up to me and asked me if I would like some old reporter magazines. And I said, sure. This I explained to them in Czech. So he went home. He got the magazines. He brought them back. I said, I paid him 80 crowns for those magazines. Well, who was he? I never asked his name. Well, I wasn't going to tell him the good friend who gave me the magazines. That would have been the last thing I would have done. So they drew up a document in which I said that I had not obtained these reporter magazines with the intention of taking them out of the country and slandering the good name of the Czechoslovak Socialist Republic. That was essentially what it was. I read it very carefully and I signed it. Then I think I was feeling a little bit cheeky, so I then asked politely in Czech if I could have the magazines back. And I said, they're already in American libraries, these are for my personal use, and I've already signed a statement that I'm not going to slander the Czechoslovak Socialist Republic, so I'm a man of my word. And they said, nah, we're not going to give you your magazines back. So I was only too glad to get out of there. I assumed in the meantime they'd called back to Prague, they checked on my whereabouts, they found out all they needed to know about, and somebody in Prague told him, whatever you do, get rid of Garver, get rid of him. So they put me on the next train to Munich about 3 hours later. So I could only hope. And I turned to smiles, we crossed the border, and I came there, and there were two of the German border guards out there smiling and waving. And then they began speaking to me in German, Ihre tschechische Freundin haben uns gefragt, wenn sie entweder sie haben ein anderer Koffer im Vlak oder nicht. He said, your Czech friends, he said, called over the border and asked us if you had left anything else on the train, if you had left another bag on the train, and we told them no. Of course, they had my bag. The two German ladies had handed my bag over to them, explained that the communists had, Czechs had taken me off the train. So that turned out to be a very fortuitous conversation. No telling what would have happened to the bag, so I delivered Carl Neprosh's plans to Munich, was met by a German cousin there who owned a taxi service, and I had phoned from the German side of the border to the cousin, letting her know that I was on my way late, and things turned out all right. But you had to be very, very careful around the communists. Well, I didn't know any top communists ever well. The only one I met and got to know fairly well was Milan Klusak, Minister Nekulturi. Not a nice man, if you know anything about his history, but his daughter lived with my wife and me and our two children in our home in Omaha for the fall semester when she was an exchange scholar at UNO. So I knew her, and I looked her up when we went. I went back to Prague in the fall of 1990. She'd been there in the spring, and met her father, who had held various posts, high posts in the communist government. When I did meet him in 1991, he was clearly dying of cancer. So I was in no mood to have a set to with a dying man. But he talked about, very fondly, he talked about the great idealism that we communists had. Clearly, he was disappointed that it had failed. But that's what he talked about, indicating that idealism was always a strong part of communism as it was of Nazism. But he's the only top communist I ever knew. I did have an interview with Professor Kral, one of the leading, Václav Kral, one of the leading Marx-Leninist historians, who explained to me in 1973, he says, a la prosim, Professor Garver, to není možno studovat dějiny Československé České sociální demokratické strany na konci 19. století. And also the Masaryk archive, which had been open up to 1914 when I was there as a student in 67, was now closed. And so Kral's explanation was, he said, you see, Professor Garver, some of our historians misused those archives. That was the mindset of a top Marxist-Leninist official. Fortunately, the historians I knew were otherwise. Well, things didn't turn out quite the way many of us hoped they might, or as quickly as we hoped they might. S. Harrison Thompson always told his classes, communism is unnatural to the peoples of East Central Europe, the Poles, the Czechs, and the rest. It will not last. Professor Thompson died in the mid-70s. He didn't live to see the end of it, but he did predict it. And as I look back on the 60s, it was exciting times. I was just old enough, I never shared the illusions or the delusions of the, in many respects, admirable student radicals in the United States. As the picture I showed you of Florence Virtue indicates, my wife and I did share the aspirations of the civil rights movement. And as I look back on the 60s, I would have thought at the early 60s as a very young man that John F. Kennedy might be destined to be one of the great figures of my youth. I think not. Not only was his life tragically cut short, but for other reasons, he was not the man he pretended to be, though in many respects admirable. And as I look back on it, Martin Luther King Jr. was a great man of my youth. I'm thoroughly convinced of that, as much as I'm convinced Václav Havel was one of the great men of the late 20th century and second half of the 20th century. And I would say the same thing, although I'm not a Catholic and do not share particularly the conservative religious doctrines of Pope John Paul II. He's another man, contemporary man, I greatly admire. With regard to Kennedy, I discovered in 2001, after the wacko scientist in Pennsylvania mailed anthrax spores through the US Postal Service and sickened several people and killed one older lady, the government finally took an interest in those of us who were exposed to the germ warfare experiments of JFK in 1963, and I was one of those exposed to a relative of anthrax on three different occasions in our group of five ships. We were told at the time we were being exposed to a harmless gas. We guessed as to what it was. We thought we might be testing atmospheric fallout from the last of the atomic atmospheric tests in the Southwest Pacific, but indeed it was Bacilli globigi, a relative of anthrax. There was no intention to harm us, and here I'm standing before you in advanced age and proof that the anthrax didn't get to me, or as the when this was announced to the known surviving veterans of this germ warfare experiment, that Bacilli Glopi G, coincidentally my initials, BG, is not known consistently to cause illness in healthy humans. So my view of the American 60s is as nuanced, I think, as I think my view of Czechoslovak communism was at the time, and I am still very cautiously optimistic about the future of this country and Europe. Maybe I have no right to be, but I am. Youth will always look on the bright side of things and strive somehow to make things better. I'm going to stop here and leave some time for questions. I didn't cover all I'd hoped to cover. But the world today is different than what it looked like in the 60s and different than what we anticipated in the 60s it might turn out to be. But it's by and large, in my opinion, better. I've had some arguments with high school classmates at reunions about this question, and of course it's a question on which everyone has informed opinions. Who takes the trouble to have informed opinions will not agree on everything. So I'm going to stop here and open it up to questions that you might have. I may have led you to think I would speak of something I did not speak of. If so, ask me about it. Rád bych mít některé otázky. Yes, Mila.
Thank you. My question is, you were really the American in Europe, weren't you? Not only in the Czech Republic, but also in the other parts of Europe, and you were observing 68 throughout Europe as well. Would you think kind of aloud for us, what were the common traits of the 68 year between, you know, Czechoslovakia, France, Italy, and on and on?
There are many parallels. For example, one of the equivalents of reform communism and its hope, it's a little bit like the burglar has burglarized your house and he comes back later and apologizes and said, you know, I'm sorry I took all this away from you and stole the better part of your life, but I'm really sorry and now we have to start over and let bygones be bygones. That's not a very good explanation to a lot of people. I was also very interested in the developments in Italy in 68. My wife and I spent some time in Bologna. We have a lot of time in Bologna, in fact, in the last decade, because I work in Italian history too. And Bologna had a reasonably competent communist city government. And the Italian Communist Party was, I think, the most independent of the Western Communist Party of the Soviet Union. In comparison, let's say, to the French Communist Party, the other party I studied fairly well. Wolfgang Leonhardt was a great, in fact, he wrote an excellent book on Eurocommunism. This was another hope that you could somehow bridge the enormous differences between the, they were never quite totalitarian, although they aspired to be totalitarian governments in the East Bloc, and the social democratic, socialist, even communist parties in the West. So this was a period of shared hopes that there could be a reconciliation, largely peacefully and comprehensively. And we know that hadn't happened. I always admired the Poles. Or as Karl Pieklik, my advisor, always said, Polacy so statecznie lidi. Poles are a courageous people. I mean, who else first stood up to the Nazis and shot back at them when everybody else rolled over? And besides, the Poles had to contend with the Red Army coming in 17 days later from the East. Now, I don't share the messianic views of the Polish romantics, but or some of the populist rhetoric that's ugly populist rhetoric that's coming out of Poland today, But certainly in 68, the Poles looked like they were on their way to improving things. Even the Yugoslavs. We were too short a time in Yugoslavia, and though I followed with interest the reforms in Tito's Yugoslavia, I had more optimism about the Yugoslavs than turned out to be warranted. I knew of the hatreds that emerged in World War II with the Ustasha and the bloodbath between Serbs and Croats and the ruthlessness with which Tito fastened communism on Yugoslavia. But Yugoslavia, whatever else you may say for it, was a independent communist dictatorship in 1968. And so for that reason, I had some greater hope for it than turned out to be warranted. This was shared by some of my Czech friends, too. Some of them said, and told me in 1990, I heard this from probably half dozen well-informed Czech scholars of Yugoslavia, Romania like Miroslav Tajman, that it's a good thing reformed communism didn't succeed in Czechoslovakia, because otherwise we would end up in a situation today like Yugoslavia, where there had not been a thorough disillusionment with the communist government. Tudman, certainly Milosevic, these guys were hardcore communists. I think Putin still is. God knows why Americans, although a lot of them were taking bribes, were so trusting of him. But this was a general hope in 68. There was also this hope in this country. Now, my view, as I say, of Kennedy, given my experience in the Navy and having been in Vietnam, and I was very fortunate there. I never had to shoot anybody. I was well prepared to do it, but I'm glad I never had to, much though I detest communism as being the worst system of government I ever had a chance to observe up close, personally. I never had any desire to go out and whack individual communists. And I'm glad in Vietnam the occasion never arose. But again, in this country, there was greater hopes for greater achievements. The civil rights movement did not always come out as well as those of us who supported it had hoped. So it's a worldwide event. We were in Paris at the time of the student riots some of the first student riots in the fall of 67. I was always glad our automobile was never damaged, although we were in this student quarter. Am I getting to your question, Mila?
Yes.
Are there other questions? I guess we've got time for maybe two more. Paul, did you have a question?
Yes, I do. I was curious about your feeling that you were perfectly situated to be a spy, and were probably being informed on by people that you knew.
Oh, I know I was.
So what my question is, have you seen your police archives?
Gone back to look at that yet. My hope was, as a young man, someday I'm going to live long enough to read the police records. Now, I have read through for names. I have gone through Rude Cravo, that famous expose of the STB informants list, and I found a number of my good friends on that list, including one in Omaha. And I always thought, you had to be kind of careful, even in Omaha. That's one of the things I really hated about communism was that those sons of bitches were actually controlling to some degree what I said, not what I published, but what I said over in this country under certain circumstances. I'm not going to mention that person's name because I don't have documentation independent of the Rude Cravo list, although I always suspected this fellow was in cahoots with the communists somehow, probably mainly in his tour business. I'm not going to say any more than that. But my good friend Otto Urban, my best friend. Now, this was perfect matching of the secret police. I never underestimate Czechoslovak intelligence or Soviet intelligence. They were both very good, and we've just seen how good Soviet intelligence was. They played the adolescent money grubbers at Facebook. They played them really well. and I could go on. But Otto Urban was a perfect match for me. Like a secret policeman matched the dossiers. We were the same age. Otto was about 6 months older. He's a good historian of modern Czechoslovakia. His book in German on Czech society at the end of the 19th century is an excellent work. Very fine, very knowledgeable historian. A partisan of Masaryk from all my private conversations with him. And I don't just think he was telling me what he thought I'd like to hear. One night, he had a lot of slivovitz. Oh, that's the other thing. The Czechs always like to get me to drink. I don't drink much. That's probably why I'm still alive. I never smoked except the occasional cigar, and I didn't drink much and still don't. But they tried to get me to drink. One night after 3 o'clock in the morning when we were staying with Otto Urban at his folks' house in Bilovets in Moravia, he started playing music, and he played Techa Voda Techa, that wonderful Moravian folk song, Masaryk's favorite. Then he put on some really jittery folk songs. He said, that's Bohemian. That's what Benish, that's what the Bohemians like. He said, Masaryk there was a real Czech, you know. So I thought, well, maybe the Slivovitz was talking a little bit, but Otto Urban generally liked Masaryk. Now, Otto Urban's wife had a PhD in psychology. She was a smart lady. They had 2 children, a boy and a girl, about the same age as our children. Their girl was older, their boy was younger. The son, Otto Urban Jr., is a distinguished historian of modern Czech art. We were the perfect match. I liked them. Socially, we saw a lot of them. If anybody knew me, that's what I thought at the time. If anybody knows me and wants to write me up, Otto Urban will do a splendid job. And I think he'll give me a good write-up. I don't know. But I was careful. Never talked about another Czech. So I don't think I was. Then I couldn't be sure. Even the fellow who gave me the Reporter magazines, I wasn't sure. Did he set me up? I thought, no, I'm not going to mention his name even now. He's still alive, I hope. I haven't heard from him in several years. Did he set me up? Well, when I was back in 73, I invited him out to lunch. And in the middle of lunch, just an ordinary Czech restaurant, I said in Czech, oh, by the way, you know those magazines you gave me, the border police confiscated the lot from me. Then I watched him turn almost totally white, and a look of terror came over his face. He had a lot to lose, you know, if I had to. I said, don't worry, I didn't identify you. They believe my story. So that's the other thing I hated about the communists. I mean, these are small things to dislike them about, but they made me lie. I don't particularly like to lie. I really don't, even to communists who get what they deserve. But that was the system. It was a rotten system. Everybody spying on everybody else. You've all seen the excellent East German film about the spy network in East Germany, The Lives of Others. If not, I recommend it. Gives a pretty good picture of what was going on. Glad we in the United States don't have that sort of thing. We got a lot of problems in our great country, but I don't think that's one of them.
What you said reminds me of a friend of mine who was interrogated by the police many times, and he was a Catholic. And one of the tactics that the police used, they said, you're a Catholic. That means you're not allowed to lie. Is that right? And he said, yes, but I can lie to you.
Yeah, it says we're Calvinist Protestants. We don't like to lie either. Nobody does. But it comes to communists, that's part of the game. You'd be a fool not to. I didn't like that, though. I really didn't. But we had wonderful friends, wonderful memories. I'm glad I became a Czech scholar. Several times I wondered if I made the right choice. You know, I really should have studied a heroic people like the Poles. You know, Polish history I would have been better suited for. Or my land of my Finnish ancestors. They killed 250,000 Russians in the Winter War in the late fall of 1939. And you know what Molotov said of the Finns? That describes me pretty well, too. Finny. Hard-headed. I reviewed a book recently in which the author, I liked the book, I recommended publication. I said, needs to tone down a little bit the view that the Czechs are an extraordinarily, I said they're tough people and they've been heroic on occasion, but let's not overdo this. Other countries have, small countries have stood up, and I gave Finland as an example. They stood up, and the Soviet Union, although they had to compromise their foreign policy, the Soviet Union did not occupy them after World War II, and under a close relationship left them pretty much to their own devices. So I hope those questions, I think we are, I see about 1 minute left on my watch, so I let my introducer decide what to do.
Any last questions? Well, join me in thanking Dr. Bruce Garver.